Meeting is called to order. The contest is called to order. I would now like to call the division of the district director, Sue Chudasong.
Thank you, I got promoted. Welcome. I'm so glad without contesting, you know, for this election. I'm already district director. So dignitaries, fellow Toastmasters, and welcome guests. Welcome to our Northeast Division contest. We have two contests, International Speech Contest, and first would be the Table Topics Contest. So dear contestant, this contest not meant to differentiate bronze from gold or silver. Contest meant to transform golden ore into golden ornament. As Swami Vivekananda said, that put your heart, soul, and mind even into the smallest act and success is yours. So if you want to succeed, always your desire of success has to be greater than fear of failure. With that, I would like to invite our contest Toastmaster, none other than our club road director, Tiffany Howard Solenko. So please welcome her.
Good afternoon, everyone. How are we doing?
Good.
I love seeing a packed room on a sunny Saturday, and everybody's inside enjoying Toastmasters. So welcome, and thank you for committing yourself today. But there's no contest today. What is today, everybody?
April Fool's Day.
I know. I had to. Come on. All right. Couple of housekeeping rules that I'm going to go over very quickly before I get into our typical Toastmasters script. This room, acoustics level-wise, is crazy. So those of us who have a large, loud voice, it's great. For those of us who have a tiny voice, not so great. So make sure that you are projecting your voices and enunciating where possible so that people in the back of the room are able to hear you as well as the people in the front of the room. Okay? Thank you with that. So contestants, please keep that in mind. And anybody else that is up here doing announcements, you need to project your voices. Also, the back of the room that has a great spread of food, please, no one is to be walking around in the back of the room while anybody is up here speaking. You need to be in your seats. It is distracting when there are people in the kitchen talking or people walking around. So I see a couple of bodies standing in the back of the room. I'm going to ask all of you to take your seats at this time. Thank you. The only people that should be standing ever are your sergeant-at-arms and myself or a contestant. Thank you. I like to go over and thank a lot of people that come out to our contest and help to support our district. We call them our dignitaries, and we like to give them a proper introduction. Starting at the top, our district director, Ivory Quinn. Program quality director, Iqbal Acha. Tiffany Howard. Our other club growth director, Bill Morrell. Our immediate past district director, Ethel Goatee. Your very own Northeast Division director, Sue Chudasama.
Director, Clarissa Douthit.
1972 Dick Store. Have I missed any dignitary that is in the room? Great job in signing in, everybody. Thank you. And welcome and congratulations on coming out to our contest today. I'm very privileged to serve as your Toastmaster for the Northeast Division, and I'm excited to be here. Northeast holds a very dear place in my heart, and I'm proud to be here today. We will have two contests, the International Speech Contest and the Table Topics Contest. The first contest will be the Table Topics Contest. When the contestants have concluded, we will have a 10-minute break. After the break, we will conduct the International Speech Contest. The contestants, timers, ballot counters, sergeant-at-arms have all been briefed prior to the beginning of this contest. Everyone is aware of the Toastmasters International rules that govern this contest. No one should enter or leave the room during the contestants' presentations. You may do so, if the time permits, during the minute of silence between presentations. Thank you, and with that said, let the contest begin.
Tabletop is contestant number one, Charles Bonilla. Wow. Wow. Imagine you have only 1 hour to live. And right now, I'm racking my brain. To whom would I ask a question? What burning answer do I need to know before I die in 59 minutes and 30 seconds or so? Let's see. Maybe I would ask my mom if she really thought I turned out all right. Maybe I would ask the wonderful young lady who accompanied me to my high school prom if, and this was a very quaint time way back then, if she would have let me kiss her on the lips as opposed to on the cheek at the end of the evening. But I think the burning answer that I would need to know before I go to my grave is this, and it would be to my lovely wife. You really do like my cooking, don't you?
Number two, Chuck Romero. You have 1 hour to live and time for only one question to be answered honestly and truthfully by anyone alive. What would you ask of whom and why? You have 1 hour to live and time for only one question to be answered honestly and truthfully by anyone alive. What would you ask of whom and why? Table Topics contestant number two, Chuck Romero.
I have 1 hour to live. Who would I ask the one question? The one question I would ask would be to Viktor Frankl, who wrote Man's Search for Meaning of Life. Madam Table Topics Master, fellow Toastmasters, honored guests. Viktor Frankl was in a prison camp during World War II. And in that prison camp, he discovered that there were a lot of people that were suffering, many from depression, mental depression. And as a psychiatrist, psychologist, he began to think about his life in prison. And what he discovered was that there was a meaning of life, even though it was nothing but darkness. And I would like to have Viktor Frankl in my presence for that 1 hour and ask Mr. Frankl, what is the meaning of life? I already know what his book says. His book says, the meaning of life is that it's not about the end goal. It's about the journey. It's about experiencing life right now and accepting whatever the journey is, whether it's bad or good or fearful, but to enjoy the struggle, to accept the struggle. To be able to say that in a prison camp is an amazing awareness. What he discovered was that he could help other people that were suffering by explaining to them that acceptance of the now and to keep pushing forward was the most important thing in life. And that's what I experienced today, is that we all struggle, but we have to keep pushing forward, and that really, right now, could be the best time we ever had. And that is the question I would ask Mr. Frankl.
Contestant number 3, Robert Kleiner. You have 1 hour to live and time for only one question to be answered honestly and truthfully by anyone alive. What would you ask of whom and why? You have 1 hour to live and time for only one question to be answered honestly and truthfully by anyone alive. What would you ask of whom and why? Table topics contestant number 3, Robert Kleiner.
I'd have to ask you, is that an April Fool's joke? Does she know something that I don't know? I only have an hour to live? Profound question. 1 hour to go. It's very, very deep. And it's ironic. I was just watching, we rented the movie with my wife, Sully. And it's about this pilot that had a land in the Hudson River in New York. Can you imagine what those people thought? That they're going to crash and probably die? What's going through their minds? It's profound that you asked me that. And if I had an hour to live, the most important people in my lives are my family, my wife and kids. And I would ask him, did I serve you? Did I make you happy? Did I teach you something? Did you learn to become a loving, better person? And was I partly responsible for that? Did I make you laugh? You know, was I silly? The main thing I could say is, was I present for you? Did I make your day? And did we have fun? Because in the end, that's all it's about. We try to create some lasting memories and have fun. And if I was part of that in your lives, then it was all worthwhile. Thank you. Thank you.
Table Topics contestant number 4, Mark LeBron. You have 1 hour to live and time for only one question to be answered honestly and truthfully by anyone alive. What would you ask of whom and why? You have 1 hour to live and time for only one question to be answered honestly and truthfully by anyone alive. What would you ask of whom and why? Table Topics contestant number 4, Mark LeBron.
Honored guests, the question is, if I could have any question answered truthfully, and I would ask, I'm going to go with a loaded one, half the crowd's going to hate me, half of you going to hate me. President Trump, what's the plan, man? I want to know the scoop. I don't care what your affiliation is here. What is going to happen? Either way, I don't care if you're going to rally everyone behind you or it's going to continue to be chaos, but I can't even tell what's going to go on. I listen to it with the rest of you on the radio. It's chaos, and we all want to know what's going to happen. It doesn't matter who wins. We just don't want to know where to put our chips. We want a little bit of an inside scoop. It's different now. The game has changed. I don't know what to do with myself. I go home and listen on the radio. I don't know what I'm going to hear. And I need to know whether I should buy a house in a couple of years or move to frickin' Europe. But even that's not a good bet anymore, guys. Nowhere is safe. The right wing is coming up, and I don't care where you stand. It's not good news for anybody. We all don't like uncertainty, and that's all I want here, guys. A little bit of knowledge. In 5 months, I'm going to marry my beautiful fiance, and I am so looking forward to our future together. And like any new family, that's what we want, guys. A little bit of certainty about what your future's going to hold. And I know just a little peace of mind with her. But the country, the world itself, what's gonna happen? What are we all gonna do? That's why I would ask President Trump what the plan is. That's all I wanna know. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you. Table Topics contestant number 5, Jeff Stein. You have 1 hour to live and time for only one question to be answered honestly and truthfully by anyone alive. What would you ask of whom and why? You have 1 hour to live and time for only one question to be answered honestly and truthfully by anyone alive. What would you ask of whom and why? Table Topics contestant number 5, Jeff Stein.
Sunday morning, I get together with my friends, and I play Dungeons and Dragons. Okay, I have a 20th level paladin with a +5 holy avenger, and here's the thing. We run upon this dragon, and it says to me, you can have one wish. My first wish, can I have more wishes? My fellow Toastmasters and guests, my first question is, I have more questions. But if I can't have more questions, I guess it starts with the obvious. Why do we question? Why do we think that way? Why are we inquisitive? Why are we curious? What makes us think? What makes us tick? What makes us adventurous? What makes us think about different aspects of life? Why is the sky blue? Why is the grass green? Why is that thing blue? Let's be honest. We all have a million questions. We only get one question. I only get 1 hour. I feel like Rodney Dangerfield in Back to School. Well, that one guy has the question in 27 parts. And you want to break that guy into 27 parts. So if I can't have more questions, the obvious thing is to ask why we ask questions and to find out the answer. So that when I ask questions, I can do better and better. And I gotta tell you, that wish spell, when you ask for that question, you gotta word it carefully, or otherwise, it's worthless. I end up with yaks as a result. That's the topic answer.
Contestant number 6, James Dominella. You have 1 hour to live and time for only one question to be answered honestly and truthfully by anyone alive. What would you ask of whom and why? You have 1 hour to live and time for only one question to be answered truthfully and honestly by anyone alive. What would you ask of whom and why? Table Topics contestant number 6, James Dominella.
One question, 1 hour. So many thoughts are racing through my mind at rapid speed. I have a lifetime opportunity to get the question I've always wanted answered. There's so many things that I could think of and that I could reach out. And who would I ask? Well, Toastmasters, fellow Toastmasters, guests, friends, the question that I would ask is to none other than one of my favorite idols, Mr. Steve Jobs. He's passed now, but I'm sure in his great experience and his great wisdom, he'll be able to provide me an excellent answer to the question I desire. I would ask of Mr. Jobs what his experiences were in life that have really changed him and had him focus on making this world a better place. There are so many things in this world and so many challenges that we face day in and day out that I'd be curious to hear his impact on someone who had the power and the knowledge and the opportunity to revolutionize the world and change the way we looked at things. All of us now have smartphones in our pockets, have computers in our homes, and we're all connected in ways that we have never been before. We've brought the world together and we've brought it closer. And to understand his vision and his impact on how he would answer that question would really shed a lot of light on how I could live my life, how I could change how I do things, how I could think differently in order to become a positive impact and make sure I leave the world in a better place than I found it. This question, I think, holds a lot of weight, and from that, I would gain so much more than just a simple answer. Thank you.
Thank you.
Toastmaster, we have all the ballots.
Let me condense some information here very quickly for you. For those of you that are here today, you are going to be watching the best of the best from the Northeast Division go on and compete at the Spring Conference. The Table Topics Contest will be on Friday, April 28th, and the International Speech Contestant, the contest will be on Saturday, April 29th. If you have already registered as a club, fantastic. If you have not and are debating it, please do so. You can also register as an individual, and the best way to do so is just to visit d30toastmasters.org. Just go to conferences and TLIs and click on the spring launching a new legacy. There is so much for me to share with you about this conference, but I will do my very best to respect your time and share with you probably the three biggest things you need to know. Number one, our keynote speaker is Magnus Jansen, our current international director from Region 5, flying all the way from Indianapolis. He's going to come here and he's going to share a wealth of knowledge about how to become a better leader. He's big into racing, and so you're going to find a lot of analogies between racing and leadership. So for those of you that like Indy 500, guess what? That's the place to be. Of course, I've already mentioned the contest or Table Topics International Speech. As all of you know, the winner of the international speech doesn't stop there. They go on to compete at the World Champion of Public Speaking semifinals and the international stage, which this year will be in August in Vancouver, British Columbia. Ooh. And we have a slew of educational sessions, 17 speakers to be exact, and we will be sharing a variety of different topics. So if you are a rookie, first-time Toastmaster, never before been to this organization, if you're experienced, if you're looking to take your A game up and become a real professional speaker and learn some things about technology and business, this is the place to be. Now, before I end this session, I think it's important for you to understand that as Toastmasters, there's one more thing that you need to do to be able to capitalize on this great event. And for me to talk to you about that, I want to call up our club growth director, Mr. Bill Morrill, to talk to us about one special thing. And so, guys,
to announce me. It's okay. one thing that Iqbal maybe forgot to mention. Is there a deadline for people to register for conference?
Oh, yeah, the price.
What's the deadline?
Today.
No. April 21st. So I just, one little piece that I think is important is, April 21st is your deadline to register for conference, also for meals. So there's nothing sold on site, right, Iqbal?
That's right, no food available after April.
So make sure you're thinking about that ahead of time. We have a really good package this year that they came up with that's very inexpensive and allows you to come to dinner and lunch at one rock bottom price. And there's an extra special gift that I'm not going to tell you what it is, but that you can get for going to dinner. So you're going to want to be there. All right, so Bill, what's tomorrow?
Well, just in case you haven't heard, there's a team on the south side and there's a team on the north side. Those men in blue on the north side just happen to be defending their World Series title starting tomorrow. Let's hear from those Cubs. So the Cubs start tomorrow, and imagine if you were at Wrigley Field or White Sox Park, that's what we do name they have for that, and there was nobody in the seats. It wouldn't be as exciting as a game. As I look around here, we have the seats filled, and that's where the excitement's coming from. The same thing is true in your clubs. You want to have your clubs filled. In order to do that, we need to pay that ticket price. We need to have you pay your memberships. Now, we're doing a great job. We've got a lot of people who have paid their memberships over the last couple weeks. And as Ivory said a moment ago, is that today is a deadline. You want to get your dues in today with your treasurer if you haven't already. If not, you will roll off of the lot. Now, it's okay. You don't have to roll off permanently. All you need to do is talk to your treasurer. You'll be a little bit late. But we don't have that grace period like we used to have. As of Monday morning, when the new rosters come out for your club, if you haven't paid, you'll be technically off that club. But we want you back. So go ahead and get that ticket price. Your renewal of your memberships for $45. Get that paper in clubs and fill those seats so you can continue the excitement of Toastmasters! Woo!
My little sneak in as I see a couple of Starbucks coffee cups around the room and things like that. Toastmasters is a quarter a day. A quarter a day. So if you find the value in your Toastmasters membership, and I think that you do, dig that quarter out and pay your $45, okay? Thank you, everybody, for coming. We have, hold on. I'm going to bring us back for a break, but who else is speaking? Is there another? Oh.
All right, let's hear for Ivory, Assistant Director.
How many chief awards since October? October 1st. Well, if you achieve an award yesterday.
Yesterday was the cutoff. Yeah.
Cutoff.
Yeah.
I'm going to feed you dinner.
What?
Friday night. So when you get that email, sign up and say, hey, we're going to have a big celebration on Friday night. Mm-hmm. Don't miss it. And with that, I'm going to call up Sue.
Yeah.
All right. Today is April Fool's Day, and we have someone special and whose birthday we are going to celebrate. So I would like to call Clarissa here.
Technical difficulties. So real quick, while we're filling that void, we passed out raffle tickets. If you did not get a raffle ticket, I'm not doing it now, so you don't have to dig, but if you did not get one already, come see me during the break, because it's before we can resume the contest, we'll do a raffle. Okay.
All right. Somebody's walking.
There we go.
Okay, make it.
So it's Kathy Stroh's birthday. We're all going to say happy birthday to her.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday, dear Cassie. Happy birthday to you.
exactly. We're going to come back at 3 o'clock on the button. So make sure you get everything that you need and be back in here at 3 o'clock. I'm sorry, 3 o'clock. Yes, Mr. Greg Thompson, I'm waiting on you.
Wow.
I'm just kidding. Thank you, everybody, for coming back from our 10-minute break. It goes so quickly. But we did hand out the last of the raffle tickets, so we're going to do our raffle at this time. This is the last call, so I didn't have anybody else, a few people come up, so everybody please take out the raffle tickets at this time. James, come on up. You are my last one that we'll give one out to.
I
read
them.
I read raffle. Contestants have other things on their minds sometimes.
There we go. This is it right here.
All right, so I'm going to call up our illustrious district director and our program quality director, Iqbal Acha and Ivory Gwynn. They're going to help MC this event.
Iqbal Acha is going to go over the rules.
Rule number one, have a ticket. Rule number two. So we're going to make this a little bit more fun and engaging. Six numbers on the ticket, I would presume?
Yes.
Every time I say a number that matches what you have, you are going to say hot. So for example, if you have 361, you're going to say hot. If you have 4, you will say hot. So let's give this a try, right?
And I have the actual...
Hot!
It wasn't a number.
So this is a sample. That's a sample.
It's not
139.
Hot.
6.
Hot.
Okay, so this works. And this is how we want to do it. We're going to throw this one back in here. No reason why someone should be disenfranchised. Mm-hmm. 139.
Hot.
6.
Hot.
0.
Hot.
6.
Hot.
8.
On fire.
You have it? Oh. Come on up, everybody!
That's a Toastmasters pen and pencil set.
All right, number two, 139. 6. 0. 9.
Who's fired?
6. Next one is 139. 6. 0. 9. 7.
Cold.
Who's on fire?
7. 7. Come on up there. It's all about public embarrassment.
So we're giving you the $10 Toastmasters gift certificate.
All right, 1-3. See, I had to mix that up a little bit. 9-6. 1. 0. 1.
Hot.
9.
Hot.
6.
Hot.
0.
Hot.
but the almost all quintet. So.
One.
Pass.
Three.
Pass.
Nine.
Pass.
Six.
Pass.
Zero.
Pass.
Seven.
Pass.
Eight.
Yeah.
One, three, nine.
Hot.
Six.
Hot.
Zero.
Hot.
Nine.
Hot.
Four.
Wrong number.
Phil. Dip. You still have chances. So, 139. Six. Zero. Six.
Contestant number three, Ben Sanders. Contestant number 4, John Benichek. Contestant number 4, John Benichek. Contestant number 5, Gloria Kim. Contestant number 5, Gloria Kim. And contestant number 6, Carl Seidman. Contestant number 6 will be Carl Seidman. We will now proceed with the international speech contest. There will be 1 minute of silence in between each contestant. Timekeepers, when I advise you to do so, please signal me with the green light when 1 minute is up. After all contestants have spoken, the judges will be given all the time that is necessary to complete their ballots. Now let's get excited. This is for district level, everybody. Let's start the contestant number 1, Heather Vaughn. Never give up. Never give up. International speech contestant number 1, Heather Vaughn.
Never give up. Winston Churchill. Madam Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, during a difficult time in your life, did you ask yourself, why me? I found myself asking that question during a very uncertain period in my life. Until my 30s, I didn't understand what it meant to trust yourself. With years of low self-esteem from being bullied as a kid, I went on to, as an adult, to not only struggle to trust myself, but also my decisions. That would all change unexpectedly when I learned what it takes to develop personal trust. You develop personal trust when you never give up. Let's travel back in time. It was 2012, and after being unemployed for over a year, I was hired by the federal government to train as an air traffic controller. If I successfully completed the 5-month program, my career would take off. Earning $130,000 a year. I canceled my apartment lease here in Chicago, sold almost all of my belongings, and left for Oklahoma City to begin that training. After months of aviation study in brightly lit classrooms, traffic pattern simulations in dark bunkers, and a growing fear that the job of an air traffic controller, because of the lives involved, was not for me. My fear was realized. I couldn't handle the pressure and failed the final 2 tests. That meant I was out of the program and was told to go home. But I left everything to be there. I can't go home. Not only was I unemployed again, I was now homeless. With no destination, it was a long drive out of Oklahoma City. There was a lot of time for my mind to wander. My emotions included embarrassment. What will my family think of me? I'm a failure. After a few cold nights in my car, I finally called my mom and told her what happened. She invited me back to my childhood home in Ohio. Now, don't get me wrong, that's my mom. But 2 women and a 500 square foot house with only 1 bathroom. I needed to find a job fast. A few weeks passed and no interviews. I knew I needed help, so I paid someone to fix my resume. A few more weeks passed and nothing. Also during that time, I decided to reach out to my former bosses from corporate America to see if I could use them as references. Now, when I worked for them, this is an era in my life I like to call BT. Before Toastmasters. Before
Toastmasters, I was extremely quiet, which they understandably didn't like. But they all agreed I was a strong performer. I thought one of them would help. I contacted each of them, and they never responded. Soon, 8 weeks would pass, and I was regretting ever going to Oklahoma City. A useless resume, no high-flying $130,000 a year job. I wanted to do what I knew best, give up and hide. A nearby McDonald's became a place of refuge. And no, not because of the French fries. But their hard wooden chairs were a means of support that kept me from getting too comfortable in my predicament. One day, I was so stressed, more than usual. I was like a Cubs fan during Game 7 of the World Series. My head and my hands. I scanned the career website I had open on my laptop. That's when a footnote on the page caught my eye. It said, "Call for free help with your resume." So I did. Marie answered. I told her, "I don't have the money to pay for another resume. Can you please help me to fix what I have?" With a sweet smile in her voice, Marie responded, "Sure." After 5 minutes, she gave me resume tailoring tips that would go on to change my life. That night, I applied for new jobs. I eventually accepted a job that offered more money than I'd ever made in my career. 5 years later, I am now the owner of my own career consulting firm. But life is not all about making more money or fancy titles, is it? How have you allowed a time of struggle to define you? I could have continued to play it safe and not taken a chance on air traffic control. Or allowed the turbulence of that failure to cause me to question my own self-worth. If I had, I would have missed out on the gift of a lifetime. Trust in myself. To arrive at that trust requires that you don't ask, "Why me?" Instead, dust yourself off and ask, "Why not me?" You must never give up. If you get a once-in-a-lifetime big break, like my air traffic control, and it nearly breaks you, never give up. Because to move beyond your struggle to trust in yourself, you must trust in your struggle and never give up. Madam Toastmaster.
Number two, Francesca Pepia. Stress and what it can do to you. Stress and what it can do to you. International speech contestant number two, Francesca Pepia.
Thank you. traffic with the idiots around you, bills piling up, family driving you wild, that person at work who keeps getting promoted even though they're an idiot! Well, Madam Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, dignitaries, and honored guests, my husband, Douglas, was to the outside world the calmest, most laid-back person anyone would ever know. But we knew he took all that stress inside, and one day all that stress caught up with him. Doug had not been feeling well, so I told him, well, we'll just, you know, make a doctor's appointment and we'll go and see what's going on with you, and everything will be fine. So at work that day, the appointment rolls around, and he calls me and says, would you mind coming? I kind of don't feel really well, so I need you to help me come back from work, and we can drive, go home, and get the car and go to the doctor's appointment. Sure, no problem. I get there, and I see him standing waiting for me, and he looks really tired, and I think, let's just get a cab. Don't worry about it. So we get a cab. We get home. I say, just go inside and lie down, and I'll take care of everything else. So when I come inside, I see that he's not doing well. So I try to help him back into bed, but he loses his balance. But then he passes out on top of me in our very narrow bathroom, pinning me to the ground. And I do like you see on TV. Come on, Doug, stay with me. Come on, you can do it. You can do it. Come on. Panicking, thinking I just got to get to the phone. I don't want to push him or hurt him. So I finally get out from under him, get to the phone, and call 911. Well, of course, I'm the typical hysterical mess. My husband's on! And they're saying, calm down, calm down. Just go outside, prop open the door, you know, then open the door to your apartment. And I did all those things. Went back and held him in my arms. He groggily says to me, who are you talking to? I have to go to the doctor. And I think, well, this is a good sign. He's responsive. The EMTs come really quickly. They get him up on off the floor. He says to me, go and get my medicine. Tell them what I'm taking. And I go do that. And I said, this is a good sign. Things are looking up. And they put him in the chair. They don't put him on the gurney. So this is good. And I'm thinking, you know, it's troublesome, but, you know, it's going to work out. They ask me, go get his jacket and his shoes. And I'm thinking, this is really a good sign. So I said, I can't find his shoes. And I said, that's okay. We'll meet you at the hospital. Bring his shoes with you. Okay, fine. So I get in the car, and I'm right behind the ambulance. And when they take off, I'm like, we're going to stay right behind them, forgetting that the ambulance gets to go through red lights. However, I do not. So by the time I get to the hospital, I'm thinking they're going to tell me all the things that are going to happen, and you know, may have to have surgery, and all this is going to happen. So I walk up there to the emergency, tell them who I am, and they take me to the family room. This is not a good sign. And I keep asking, what's happening? What's happening? You know, I need to see him. What's happening with Doug? We have to wait for the doctor. He can't tell you anything right now. Okay, I wait for her. And then she comes in and sits down. I thought, this is when she's going to tell me the course of treatment and how everything's going to work. And I say to her, just tell me he's alive. And she says, no. What? Wait a minute. An hour ago, we were sitting in a cab together. How can this be true? This is impossible. I cannot believe it. My husband of 28 years, my life partner, my soulmate, my love of my life is dead. So Douglas was 55 years old, and the diagnosis was hypertensive heart failure. Gone. Stress will catch up with you. You have to learn to release it. I think, what am I going to do? So I do a lot of crying, a lot of emptiness. Unfortunately, I decided to fill that emptiness while making Ernest and Julio Gallo very wealthy. Not a good plan. Then I realized, look, if you really love this person, you would not throw your life away. You would respect them enough. If you won't live for yourself, live for him. So I was fortunate enough to go back to my office, and my work was allowing me to work part-time, which, let me tell you, there is a lot of paperwork to handle when someone dies. I continue to preach to people, tell the people you love that you love them, and write down your passwords. I tell you, that was a half an hour, that was a month of getting through that stuff. So I did the day walking, one, you know, people keep saying, just put one foot in front of the other, which is what I did. And one day, while putting one foot in front of the other, I was heading to the train, and I see this group of little children.
and they're all in their little summer uniforms, and they have a little counselor there, you know, getting them to hold hands so they cross the street properly, and they're doing that, and one little girl goes, "Look! A worm!" And they all gather around to see this magnificent little creature, and they're touching it and laughing and enjoying themselves. And it occurred to me, that's life. Life is now, N-O-W, never out of wonder. There's always something magnificent. I should just stop and look and see what's around me. Really appreciate life for what it is. Stress is part of life, but you do not have to be part of stress. You can say no to stress. And I suddenly looked up and I said, clouds, look at clouds, how magnificent they are. You know what clouds are made of? Dust and water. I could give you a pile of dust and you cannot add enough water to that to make a cloud. Next time you eat an orange, really look at that segment and those little tiny pockets of juice that just are magnificent. I mean, can you imagine the first guy who picked up that hairy looking nasty kiwi fruit and said, "Hey, I bet this tastes good." Think of the unbelievable things that life offers. When I think about losing half my life, what the magnificent part of it was, the friends and family, even strangers, whose love and affection and help got me through this. And one of the darkest moments, this quote came out of the blue from one of our great thinkers, Winnie the Pooh, and it said, if there is ever a tomorrow when we are not together, remember this, you are braver than you believe, stronger than you think, and smarter than you feel. And no matter what, I will always be with you. See, never out of wonder. Breathe, stress, release.
Contestant number 3, Ben Sanders. How will you spend it? How will you spend it? International speech contestant number 3, Ben Sanders.
What would you do if you won $1 billion? How would you spend it? I asked myself that question as I sat on the edge of the bed watching the evening news. It was January 13th, 2016, and the Powerball, one of the largest lotteries in the United States of America and the world, was worth over $1 billion to the person who picked the 5 numbers in Powerball correctly. I knew I was going to be a winner. Madam Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, dignitaries, guests, earlier that day, my wife and I were out driving around in the Silver Bullet, that's my 2004 Silver Honda Civic, and I determined that I needed to get some gas. So I pulled into the gas station and there was a light. Powerball, $1 billion, get your tickets here. So I leaned over to my wife and said, "Should we buy some Powerball tickets?" To which she said, "You know what Jack Shill would say." Jack Shill's my late father-in-law. He loved to save and invest his money wisely. So it was no doubt that we could hear his voice raining down to us from heaven as he pulled the pipe from his mouth and said,
You know, if you took that dollar you're about to invest in that lottery ticket, and you put it in your retirement account, in about 10 years, you'll have $1.25.
We proceeded to purchase $30 in lottery tickets, and we hit the road again. So as we're driving, she leans over. So when we win, how are you going to spend it? To which I replied, you first. So what she said was, well, first, I'm going to call my boss and quit my job. Then I'm going to work on that small business I've always wanted. I'm going to volunteer more and spend more time with our daughter. Your turn.
All right, I'll play. I'm definitely quitting my job.
I'm going to continue to work on that public speaking career I've always wanted. Oh, and I'm going to volunteer more and spend more time with our daughter. All of a sudden, a voice speaks from the back seat. It's our 7-year-old daughter, Jocelyn. Oh, great. Good to hear I'm on the list. Fourth, but I'm on the list. Number one in our hearts, dear. Number one in our hearts. You ready to go? Back to my bedroom. Let's listen for those numbers. Here they come. 4, 8, 19, 27, 34, and the Powerball, 10. Let's check our tickets. Diane, my wife is already in bed asleep. Diane, what? We won. She sits up in the bed. She grabs her phone and she starts dialing. What are you doing? Oh, I'm quitting my job. I'm quitting my job. By the way, if you talk to my wife, she will tell you that she is not much of a singer, but she was singing opera that night. Oh, I'm quitting my job. Wait, whoa, hold on, Papa Ronnie. Hold on, put the phone down. We won $4. Oh. She threw the phone at me. She kicked me. I looked at her. She looked at me. We looked up. Yeah, Jack Chill checking in from above. Let's recap. You spent $30 on lottery tickets. You won $4? That's a net loss of $26. If you'd taken that money and invested in a retirement account, we know, and we go to bed. I get up the next morning and I head down to breakfast. Is that, as I'm sitting there eating my breakfast, I think about the previous day and the odds of even winning a Powerball or any lottery for that matter. And then my mind wanders a little further to the previous Sunday when my pastor was delivering a sermon on miracles. Think about it. All of us in here, right now, in these bodies. We've all had ancestors who fought in wars, battled disease. Maybe they had a near miss with death. There might have been a couple of them that said, let's not have any kids. But they did. And here we are, right here, right now. We're all miracles. I also consider that we've beaten the odds and we have won the life lottery. Now, what's the life lottery, you ask? If 1 minute equals $1, I have already spent approximately 25 million of my life lottery winnings. Now, I'm not going to say I spent them all wisely, but many of them I have. That's why I ask you, how have you spent your winnings so far? Have you spent them wisely? Have you accomplished everything you wanted to do? Are there things you still want to do? What if you were in that car with my wife and I that day? What would you have said? Let's recap what I said. I'll quit my job. Well, over the past year, I'm looking around, and I'm almost that close to finding a new job that I'm going to find way more fulfilling. Public speaking, here I am, Toastmasters, growing and learning every day. Volunteering more? I joined a speakers bureau for one of my favorite nonprofits, Feed My Starving Children, and I am embarrassed that I had to say that I would spend more time with my daughter, because that's priceless. That's why, again, I ask you, what would you have said? Think about what I said. Do we need $1 billion to do those things? No, we don't. However, I will say, our journey in accomplishing those goals is not going to be easy. That's right. We are going to find that we are going to have obstacles all over the place. I heard a great quote that if you can find a path with no obstacles, it probably doesn't lead anywhere. Mine is filled with obstacles, and yours will be too. And that's why I encourage you to do what I've done. Find ways to energize and challenge yourself to go over, around, and through those obstacles. Of course, I rely heavily on my family, friends, and faith. But I have something new. Those lottery tickets from that night, And when I need a reminder, I look at these. And every time I look at these or I hear lottery numbers announced on the radio or the television, I realize I'm already a winner. Jack Schill was right. If we invest our money, in this case our life lottery winnings, wisely, it'll pay off in dividends and interest. That is why I ask you, my fellow miracles and life lottery winners, not how would you spend, but how will you, how will I, how will we spend our remaining life lottery winnings? Let's do it wisely. Thank you very much.
Back in the 1960s, I was convinced that I was the only teenager on this planet who was not cool. The only time I felt cool was when I was asleep, dreaming of being someone other than the nerd that I was. One night, I dreamt that a genie appeared and offered me 3 wishes. I said, "Genie, I want you to make me respected, admired, and cool." The genie said, "Sure, no problem. I'll just wait. What? How about something a little easier, like world peace?" I said, No. I don't want that at all. I want to be cool." Just then, I heard my mother knocking on the door. "Johnny, come, time to get up and go to school." "Yes, Mom." "And Johnny." "Yes, Mom." "You already are cool. You just don't realize it." "Yeah. Right. What did she know? She was an adult." And as all teenagers know, adults know nothing! But as I dragged myself off to school that morning, little did I realize something was about to occur that would soon alter my destiny. One of my nerd friends came up to me at lunch. And he said to me, "John, I'm starting a rock band and I want you to be my bass player." "Bass player? I don't know anything about playing bass." "It doesn't matter. It's rock and roll. Nobody listens to bass anyway." Well, I thought about it and said, "All right, I'm in." Isn't it funny how a little snap decision like that can change your whole life? See, I had been working every day after school as a busboy, spending most of my time staring at Kathy Instone, the salad girl, who was the most beautiful girl in my high school. I had never spoken to her for fear that my nerdiness would somehow destroy her great beauty. I never spent money going on dates in those days. Every penny that I earned went right into the bank for my college fund. The plan was to graduate as valedictorian and then win the Nobel Prize for developing a new form of energy that would completely revolutionize mankind. But on that day, plans had changed. I was gonna be a rock star now. So after school, I went to the bank and I pulled out all my money and I bought a bass guitar, an amplifier, a PA system, and began to learn songs like Louie Louie, Jumpin' Jack Flash, and Hitta Gotta Da Vida Baby. By the time summer rolled around, we were good enough to enter the Battle of the Bands contest over at St. Christopher's Church. But I didn't just want to enter. I wanted to win. And to win, a band really needed to have something extra special that none of the other bands had. Well, one morning, I woke up and I heard James Brown on the radio for the first time. This was a guy who combined horns with rock music, and I knew that this was the sound that could push us over the top. So I called up a couple of my nerd friends from the high school marching band, and I recruited a trumpet player and a trombone player, and we began to learn songs by James Brown, Chicago, and the greatest horn song of them all, Vehicle by the Ides of March. On the day of the contest, we were ready. Of the 8 bands that entered, ours was selected to perform last. So after having to wait around and forced to listen to 7 versions of Louie Louie, 7 versions of Jumpin' Jack Flash, and 7 versions of Hitta Gotta Da Vida Baby, we walked on stage. And as I looked out in the audience, I noticed that nobody was paying attention. Everyone was talking to their friends. I thought, who am I kidding? I am no rock star. I'm just a nerd. Just then, the drummer started up. 1, 2, 3, 4, and the horns kicked in. Da-da-da-da-da-da. And I started singing, I'm the friendly stranger in the back sedan. Won't hop inside my car. Everyone in the audience stopped what they were doing, turned around, and began to stare at us as if we were aliens from another planet. I knew that Einstein's theory of relativity was true, because on that day, those 15 minutes on stage felt like 15 seconds. And when our last notes flew out of our speakers and slammed into people's ears, we walked off stage to a standing ovation. As I was putting my bass guitar back into its case, I felt the presence of someone staring at me. I looked up, and there was Kathy Instone, the salad girl. And she looked so beautiful. And for the first time ever, she spoke to me and said, John, your band sounds great. Say, I'm having a party at my house Saturday night. Do you want to come? It was at that very moment that I realized that I was respected. I was admired. And I was cool. And so, if any of you here today feel that you're not as attractive or as clever as you would like to be, let me tell you right now that you already are cool. You just don't realize it.
while the judges mark their ballots. I couldn't wait to get home and grade those tests. The first few, big disappointment. I already had a draft of the letter, thinking about what I might write to whoever's responsible for the high school education of these undergraduate students, not to cut art. And then I proceeded to grade, and I thought, okay, these are engineers, I'm not in art school. As long as they're good with math and design, why should I care? The final ones, it took a very long time to grade. I actually sat in front of the mirror, and I looked at the test, looked at the mirror, and kept thinking, do I really look like that? And then when it came time to actually grade the actual tests, I found myself that I wasn't free from the stereotypes either. So when I saw an Asian-sounding name, my expectation of the math part of the test, I thought they were going to do so well, and they didn't. And let me tell you what the students drew on those papers. It reminded me of the question that my uncle was a student at Marquette in his late 50s. They did the question he always got. Mr. Lee, why do your eyes look like this? And he was a proud man. He always had an answer to that. He replied, well, I'll answer that question if you tell me why your eyes look like this. Also, when I start my class, I put up a map of the world and ask the students to guess where I'm from. This is always fun. I get a lot of Koreas because my last name, K-I-M, dead giveaway. And then I also get some Californias. California country, but I'm their engineering professor. I'm not responsible for their geography. So I give them the final answer. Big reveal, Australia. I lost my accent growing up in Canada and Germany and Korea.
and other places. And finally, I ended up with this. Now, when I was in Australia as a kid in the late 70s, I was a star attraction at a local supermarket. Not only didn't they have a lot of Asians around, and the ones who spoke with an Australian accent and English, that was novelty. Anytime I went into the store, people said, look, the chatterbox is here, the little Asian chatterbox is here. You can't imagine my big disappointment when my dad finally got a permanent job in Korea and decided to move to Korea. My mom said, you'll fit right in. You'll be with friends who look like you. I thought, okay. So I left my stardom behind and moved to Korea as a six-year-old who cannot speak the language. That is a very, very hard place to be. And later on, my Korean wasn't perfect, and I had to move to Germany for a bit and then come back to Korea. And now the expectation was, after maybe an hour or two in school, my hair will turn blonde or my eyes will turn blue. Those were the perceptions of Koreans at that time, in the 80s. Now I work in a country where I don't have to defend the shape of my eyes or even be questioned about, do you speak English? Or you speak English so well for somebody who looks like this. But I do have to question sometimes. If we have learned not to judge people by their appearances only, can we learn not to question people based on what they believe in? I still give the same extra credit question to my students, and either their art classes have gotten better, or they've gotten rid of their prejudices. Mm-hmm. So my extra credit question to you is, can you get rid of your prejudice?
Speech contestant number 6, Carl Simon, The Power of Presence. The Power of Presence, international speech contestant number 6, Carl Simon.
I remember when she and I first met. We could go everywhere together. I could tell her just about anything and she would listen. And she had this magical way of solving all of my problems, just like that. She was small and slender and fit perfectly into the palm of my left hand. Madam Contest Chair, fellow Toastmasters and guests, I love my smartphone. And she loves me. She lets me talk to people while I'm driving, text people while I'm eating, and ignore virtually everyone around me. On the bus ride into work, I can reach into my pocket, and I can write emails, and I can read articles. But my eyes are glazed and dazed into a digital hypnosis. In the hallways at work, I run into my coworker, Adam. Hey, Carl, what's new? Oh, pretty good. He looks at me confused, and I look at him embarrassed, realizing that the answer that I gave him had nothing to do with his question. In the toilet stalls of the bathroom, it isn't just business as usual. It's doing business while doing business. If you're quiet and you listen carefully, you can hear genius at work. This isn't some special day. It's like this every day. Our phones are always connected, but we're more disconnected than ever before. Our touch screens allow us to live easier, quicker lives, but we're more out of touch with ourselves and each other. Each one of us in this room, over the span of our lifetimes, we'll spend over 4 years on our smartphones. That's over 35,000 hours. When left to our own devices, it's our devices that own us. They steal our moments away and allow us to flush these precious moments down the toilet. Almost exactly 4 years ago, my wife Jessica and I took a trip to Chiang Mai in northern Thailand. After 26 hours of flying, all we wanted to do was sit back and relax. We found a small cafe on the main street and sidled up at a table sharing a nice ice-cold glass of lager beer, a perfectly refreshing drink on that swelteringly hot day. I took out my smartphone and zoned out. Honey, did you just see that? Whoa, 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 what just happened? There was this moped that was going by and this entire family was on it. The father was driving, sitting behind the father was the mother, sitting on the mother's lap was the daughter, sitting on the father's lap was the son, and straddling over the handlebars was this little boy who is eating his noodles out of a bowl with his chopsticks. That was one of the cutest things I think I have ever seen. I wish I'd been paying attention, and I wish you'd taken a picture with your camera. Who needs a camera? I'll forever have that image blazed in my memory. The famous philosopher Ferris Bueller once said, life moves pretty fast. If you don't stop and take a look around once in a while, you could miss it. Some of us travel thousands of miles away to see humanity in the raw, only to ignore the very strangers, friends, and miracles in our own towns. We seek excitement by staying busy, but forget that so much fulfillment comes from our minds just being mindful and present. Life is not always full of magnificent moments. It's also full of small moments as well. Tiny gifts that sometimes go by in a flash. After 3 months in Asia, I returned back to Chicago. And on one day on the bus ride to work, I reached into my pocket to pull out my phone. But this time was different. For the first time, I looked around that bus, and I realized that nobody was smiling. For the first time, I realized that there was an air of indifference. For the first time, I noticed that people were disposing of their time like it was a burden on their day. Instead of taking out my phone this time, I left it in my pocket, and I just sat there, present. And I looked out the window and began to notice things, almost examples as my little boy eating his noodles. That trip to Asia was more than just a trip. It was a revelation. Busy time. Bored time, uncomfortable time, free time, precious time that you and I sometimes throw away or saturate with busyness. It's time that we can simply be present. The connectedness that we feel through our phones, the touch screens that we feel from our phones, when we put them away, is connectedness that we can have with each other and be more in touch with our surroundings and with ourselves. The next time you have the impulse to take out your phone and to destroy some of this time, put it away, count to three, and take a breath. These magnificent moments and these small moments are the ink that make up the story of all of our lives. Life moves pretty fast. If you don't stop and take a look around once in a while, you could miss it.
Yeah. So, Charles, what club are you representing today?
Unity Toastmasters, 6.4!
The other two questions for you, how long have you been in Toastmasters, and what Toastmaster educational level are you?
I have been in Toastmasters for 7 years, and I am an ACB ALB.
All right. Now, looking off your sheet here, and I know a little bit about Charles, but I'm really going to go off of the plug that's here, because why not? You put it. It says, it says notable accomplishments. Area governor was extremely rewarding, and youth leadership program was inspiring. So I'll allow you to speak to that, because Charlotte and I were area governors together, but why was it so inspiring?
Area governor? Okay, well, area governor was rewarding because an opportunity to coach, in my case it was 6 clubs, it was phenomenal, and to make those club visits and to take in the dynamic of each of those clubs, I was always able to take something back to my home club from and to be enriched and to cross-enrich and to encourage relationships between those clubs, that some of which continue today. That's wonderful as area governor. Youth leadership program is totally the way to go. If you're looking to for an advanced level, you know, award, pursue the youth leadership program. I chose to do it for a high school class. I did it for 3 consecutive years. I partnered with a fellow club member, and everyone complains about, oh, the kids today, the youth wave, blah, 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 blah. But you know what? The youth leadership program will inspire you. The enthusiasm that they brought to the program, the way they opened up their hearts through their table topics and their speeches, if that does not inspire you, then you're dead.
Well, we have a couple of youth in the audience today, so I wanted to take note of that. So thank you so much for participating. What club are you representing today?
Toastmasters of Lincoln Park.
How long have you been in Toastmasters?
This time, I'm in my 3rd month, but I took a 3.5-year break. I was a member of Toastmasters of Lincoln Park for almost 7 years.
And Toastmasters educational level?
I completed the 10. I've forgotten what they're called.
Competent communicator?
Competent communicator.
Great job with that. So I'm going to see here, interests and hobbies, nutrition, exercise, being in shape, and public speaking. Well, public speaking comes without saying, right? Nutrition, exercise, and good shape. How do you do, what are you doing to keep that on your hobbies or your regimen?
Well, I am doing public speaking, which really takes a lot of calories. I try to work out at least 4 or 5 days a week. And I just really watch what I eat, those two things.
Okay. And real quickly, I see your favorite quote is, I do not fear dying, I just don't want to be there when it happens. So because of the table topic question, I absolutely had to. But who stated that and why is it your favorite quote?
Woody Allen, of course. It's my favorite quote because I love humor, and I think that anybody that is funny is really smart. Combination of two qualities.
Well, thank you so much for meeting today. Hello, Robert. How are you?
How are you? You know, the first two gentlemen, they have so much meaning and they've done so much great work with Toastmasters. Me, I came here today because I knew there'd be food here. So
the Toastmasters,
right.
There's usually food. What club are you representing today?
I'm in Speaking of Success Toastmasters. We're out of Glenview.
Yeah. How long have you been in Toastmasters?
This is my 6th year in Toastmasters. You know, one of these days I'll get it right. But.
And your Toastmasters educational level?
I am the DTM.
Interest and hobbies. So I'm going to go off of, you have music, dancing, comedy, and good food. So you brought up food again, but of these, is there one particular that you like the most?
Well, I gotta tell, I'm not eating very well, you can tell by my size, but comedy, it's all about the comedy. It really just, you know, anything you do, just try to have some fun and don't take everything so seriously.
And your favorite quote is your own, so I'm going to let you give it to us.
Yes, my own quote, a Kleinerism. A good laugh makes you feel good.
All right. Well, thank you so much for participating today.
You will pick Toastmasters 8623.
And how long have you been in Toastmasters?
Well, coming up on 5 years.
5 years. Oh, it's been that long. And what is your educational level?
A, C, B, and CL.
All right, all right. Great. Let's see. Notable accomplishments? Matching socks?
Today as well.
We like when people match their socks. I had to note it. It's the only one on here, so I had to talk to that. But let's see here. Interested hobbies is biking. Where do you bike?
I have moved into the Chicago area, so I'm just now learning how to dodge traffic. It's a valuable skill. You gotta keep an eye out, you know, getting creamed or doored or any of these risks. But it's worth it. I make a bit of a triangle. It takes about an hour to go around Jefferson Park and the surrounding areas.
Isn't
that nice?
It's my old stopping grounds, absolutely. Well, thank you so much for competing today. Thank you. Same questions for you. You know the drill. What club are you representing?
There's a drill. I'm leaving.
I'm with Niles Township Toastmasters, 665. Been around for 68 years, so we're happy about that. I am a distinguished Toastmaster. Yes.
How long have you been a Toastmasters?
2008, so I guess that makes it almost 9 years now. So there you go.
You competed enough, you should know the answer. All right, so we're going
to... No, that's math. I don't know.
You did not get much to go off of on here, so I might have to improvise. But interests and hobbies, spending too much time on Facebook, so that goes along with Carl's speech. Role-playing you brought into your speech, and then world domination. So why don't we talk to world domination?
I figured we'd go someplace different. I mean, let's be honest, raise your hand. Who doesn't want to be a world dominator at some point in some way? Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's not necessarily full domination. I mean, you want to dominate your field, and then you can work from there. You know, I just need to find my local horde, and then I can work from there, and then it'll be good. But we'll see.
And then your favorite quote is, I like life, it's something to do.
Yep.
Why is that your favorite?
The alternative sucks.
That's giving me a lot to work with today. Hello, James. How are you?
I'm doing well.
I can look very high up at you.
I can get lower.
No, it's okay. All right, same questions for you. What club are you representing today?
All State, relatively speaking. I've been with Toastmasters for a little over 4 years, and in that time I have gotten my Advanced Communicator and Advanced Leader Bronze.
Right. So, interests and hobbies, racquetball, bowling, spending time with family and friends, traveling, and cars. So I know a couple of these from past, but I'm going to let you hone in on one of them if you'd like.
Sure. So we'll go with racquetball, which is actually one of my favorite things to do. It's a great game to play. Not enough people play it, so if anyone's interested, hit me up afterwards. But racquetball is an interesting one, because when I first got involved with Toastmasters about 4 years ago, I was a target speaker for a competition, and I spoke about racquetball. And from that moment on...
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Pretty well. So what club are you representing today?
North Suburban 612.
So few in the audience today. What educational level are you?
ACB.
ACB. And how long have you been in Toastmasters?
4 years this month.
4 years. Wow. Congratulations. All right. Let's see here. Notable accomplishments is third district speech evaluator. So I'm assuming at the district level you took third?
Yes.
All right. Tell us about personal development. So I know that you've been on quite a bit of journey with your personal development. Why is that one of your big interests or hobbies?
I think it's important to continue to change. Well, not really change, but to figure out who you are. If you continue to
repeat old habits, then you really need to evaluate while you're repeating them and why they make you so unhappy. And when you do that, you really grow from there.
And then I like your quote, so I'm going to bring upon that. Every struggle brings new lessons. So I think that ties in really well to your international speech today, saying, you know what, it was a struggle, but somehow you brought light from that. So tell me why, I'm assuming it's your favorite quote for that reason, but give me a little bit of background.
I think when it's tempting to hide and to blend into the background. I know that I've done that probably 90% of my life. But when you go through life and you allow life to happen and you allow the consequences to happen and then you are open to learning from them, then it's not really a struggle, it's a lesson.
Well, thank you so much for competing today.
Unity Toastmasters.
How long and what's your education?
6 years and I'm accomplished bronze and I've just now got my leadership, so I guess I'll be having dinner with you.
All right, we'll see you on Friday. All right, great. So real quickly, I'm looking at interests and hobbies. Ukulele. So that interests me a little bit because you don't see much of that on here. How much do you play?
Not as much as I'd like to. I mean, I wanted to play because my grandfather's trying to teach me. He's like, my fingers don't go that way. It's like, well, you're only 7, so it's okay. And then somebody said, well, I have a ukulele. And then I was like, well, the classes are so far away. And then I saw a thin sign that said, ukulele lessons will come to your house. It's like, hey!
Anything that comes to you.
Yeah.
Absolutely, that's great. And then I see also musicals. Do you have a favorite musical?
I love most musicals. Actually, I just was in a musical writing workshop, and I just finished a musical adaptation of Turner Island, which is going to have a reading in Los Angeles at the end of this month.
Wow. Hi there. How are you doing,
Ben? I'm doing well.
All right. So, what club are you representing today?
I'm representing Corporate Club, relatively speaking, from Allstate.
Woo!
I've been in Toastmasters now for about 6 years, and I have my ACB and my AL.
All right, great. All right. Let's see. Interests and hobbies. Football. So I remember a speech a couple years ago that you came here in your football gear.
Yes.
So how much do you love football?
I love football a lot. I'm actually in an organization called the Professional Ultimate Fans. It's PFUFA. .org, and if you watch TV and you see some of those fans dressed up, I know all of them. I actually wear a hard hat, and I'm TNT is my nickname, and I have a good time. I'm a Cowboys fan, so I go to Cowboys games, but if you ever go to a Bears game, you see that guy with the bear head on top of his head, and his face painted up, that's my friend Don.
Do you know the Cheesehead ones too?
Yeah, I do. My friend Steve Tate and a whole bunch of them up there. Yeah, I go up there. Great people. Great rivalry.
So every once in a while you might be the one that's in the painted colors running around.
I don't paint my face, but you know why? It takes a lot of time for those guys. They get up like 2 hours early and just paint their faces. So, no, I don't paint my face.
That's taking it to a whole other level.
That is. That
is awesome though. All right. So at the favorite quote, everyone is fighting a battle that you know nothing about. Why is that? Be kind always.
Everyone is fighting a battle you know nothing about. Be kind always. Several years ago, actually, I competed in this very contest in not this building, but the building over. And it was about my battle with depression that I had to overcome and where I've come since then. And I believe that no matter where you are, where you're sitting, the person next to you is fighting some sort of battle. So be nice, be kind to everybody, because you never, never know.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much for competing today. Hello, John. How are you?
I'm doing fine.
All right, so same questions for you. What club are you representing today?
Margaret's Toastmasters 381.
Yeah.
I paid them. So. I'm communicator bronze and leadership, whatever the lowest one is. Yeah, that's it. I'm a competent leader.
Competent first, right?
Yeah, that's the hard part. Yeah.
So I see theater, You're currently in Fiddler on the Roof.
Well, I just closed Fiddler on the Roof.
Just
I was,
closed.
I was Tevye.
Current at the time when this was
and when that was written, yes.
Absolutely. So, what did you play?
I was Tevye, the milkman, and Abram, the bookseller, is out there in the audience right now. It was a good time.
All right. Well, that's great. I mean, I can tell by your personality, you're one of those that definitely is a theater person. You like to be out there, and you like to show off, so that's good. And then your favorite quote, a winner never quits, a quitter never wins.
That's
so
right.
Why is that your favorite quote?
Well, that's a quote from a Packers guy by the name, you probably know, he's got a street named after him up there, Vince Lombardi. And basically, if you really want to do something really well, just work really hard. When I was very young, I was a stutterer, and I found if I worked really hard at speaking, I would no longer stutter. And that seems to have worked.
Yeah, it's proof positive that
yes.
It worked, right?
Yeah.
Just one of the most gorgeous parts of the world, if any of you have ever been there. Just beautiful camping, hiking, mountains, water. Just mesmerizing.
Jealous. I'll have to check that out. And then one last piece is, inspires you most is people who are overcome adversity. So what have you seen or why is that your favorite?
I'm just always impressed by people who have been dealt a difficult deck of cards at any point in their lives. And what they do to just deal with it. I don't find that many people who have been dealt a bad deck just give up, throw up their hands and give up. And I'm just always impressed with people who are challenged and come up with ways of dealing with that.
Well, thank you so much for coming today. A very big round. are a great audience. We're going to bring up a few people to introduce the awards, because I'm pretty sure you want to know who won. So I'm going to bring up Sue Chudasama and also the remaining district leadership at this time. That's amazing.
Thank you. standards.
Understanding what this is. This is education. It's education for you. So get your CC and lead your clubs. Now turn it back to her.
Thank you.
Excellent. I know.